I'll never forget the first speech I wrote for the president, where it was a speech he delivered in Puerto Rico.
Buenos tardes.
I remember thinking how totally bizarre that was. As a speechwriter, you're always recognizing that it's not really my idea, right? It's inspired by President Obama, but just the fact that you can sit down and be part of that is, it's totally surreal. I mean, and it never stops being surreal.
You were just 24 years old when you started at the White House. How did that come about?
I did not mean to become a speechwriter. I didn't really mean to go into politics or anything like that. I was on a plane and we had just begun our initial descent, and I was sort of channel surfing on the free airplane cable. I saw this candidate who I had heard of but didn't know a lot about, named Barack Obama.
They said this day would never come.
By the time that speech was over, I was like, never mind, whatever he's doing, I want to be part of that. I was totally awestruck. It was really one of those moments where, like, by the time we hit the tarmac, I was on a totally different life path, and that doesn't happen a lot, but it was a heck of a speech.
You did this because you believed so deeply in the most American of ideas, that in the face of impossible odds, people who love this country can change it.
What are some of the biggest challenges in helping to craft a speech for the most powerful person on the planet?
You have to realize how high the stakes are. We would write speeches knowing that there are people whose full-time job is to pick apart every single word the president says, and sometimes just to take things out of context. And that can be incredibly intimidating.
How do you even get started working on a speech for the president? What's your process?
If I really didn't know what I wanted to write, I would try saying it instead. Speeches aren't meant to be read, they're meant to be heard. And so if I felt like I could start to finish make that argument in my own words, just talking to myself, then I could go back and begin to shape it in a way where it would make sense for the president.
What have been your sources of inspiration when you're going through this process?
Sometimes what I would do is I would go on YouTube and pull up that video of that Iowa speech from 2008 and hit play.
They said this day would never come.
Rewatching those words and feeling that sense of both power and responsibility, you know, kind of keeps you going when you wonder whether it's all making a difference. I worked on the Obama campaign in 2008, and all of my volunteers, when I left, they took one of those hope posters, and on the back in cardboard, they all just signed their names. And so I had it sort of faced the other way, where the hope side was against the wall, so that I could see all the names. And it was just this reminder that what I was doing was not just about my job, it was not just even about the president, it was about people in places like the one where I had worked. For me, really, all of my rituals are about trying to recapture that feeling I had in 2008, to put you back in that mindset when you're 21, 22 years old and you're absolutely sure you can change the world and you're pretty sure you can do it tomorrow.
You've worked on a number of White House Correspondent Dinner speeches, which are known for highlighting the president's humor. How has comedy been a tool for you in terms of getting a political message out?
Well, one of the interesting things over the last 8 years is getting people's attention has become harder and harder and harder. I wrote some speeches on climate change that I'm very proud of, but they didn't have a huge audience. We did something with Luther the Anger Translator, and President Obama got really upset over climate change deniers in Congress, and that had, I think, 40 million views on Facebook.
Rising seas, more violent storms.
You got mosquitoes, sweaty people on the train, stinking it up. It's just nasty.
Something that's funny just gets people to pay attention. It gets people engaged.
President Obama has amazing comedic timing.
Yeah, he really does. The president can hold a pause for just the right amount of time that there's a little bit of tension and then cut it with a punchline.
Being president is never easy. I still have to fix a broken immigration system, issue veto threats, negotiate with Iran, all while finding time to pray 5 times a day. Which is strenuous.
And then there's also just moments when you write something, whether it's a joke or a more serious line of argument, that breaks through in some way and becomes part of this national conversation around an issue. And a lot of the time, that's a team effort. But to be one part of that team, it's a special thing.
What have you loved most about working with the president, with President Obama?
Well, I think there is, there's just something extraordinary about working for somebody who is such a good writer, such a good speaker, and has the ability to just walk into a room and create memories that everybody else is going to remember for a lifetime. And so you get to be part of all of these life-changing moments in little ways, in big ways, and that is, you know, when I walk into a room, that doesn't happen. So that was nice to get to play a small part in that.
How do Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump differ when it comes to giving political speeches? Be sure to watch this episode of Seeker Daily to learn more.
Clinton is trying to reach out to younger voters who may not be familiar with the Clinton legacy. And this may take a little extra effort than it would take Trump, who already has an established television presence.
I think for somebody who is, by her own admission, not a natural performer, she is trying to, you know, get better and better and focus attention where it needs to be.